So Couchbase Sync Gateway. So this is our 102 session. This will follow after this one. So this is happening at 3:50 Eastern. I'll be talking about how to secure your mobile application. So I recommend you attending that one too. Also peer-to-peer, Wayne talked about some of the topology strategies here. So we'll be diving into Couchbase 103 session, which is also dealing with topology. So that's the end of the day. That'll round up the mobile talks. So I want to talk about Couchbase Lite now. And Couchbase Lite, in particular, is an embedded framework for mobile and desktop application. Comes in the form of a static or dynamic library that you link into your mobile applications. It has a NoSQL data model, and in particular, it's a document database, very much like Couchbase Server. Querying is done by using MapReduce, the same technique. Same technique that the Couchbase Server and PouchDB supports. We support change notification that let you do reactive UI development. So that's really neat. And the most important part, I think, the crown jewel feature of it all is that the entire mobile solution supports full multi-master replication. So let's talk about the crown jewel a bit and why it's important. First, replication helps. So your seats. Yeah, replication helps with taking your network off the most critical path. So avoids network latency for data access. Gives your application full offline support, or helps with creating hybrid applications that will support online features in combination of offline access. You have full control over conflict resolution. So conflict does happen, and if so, we provide the support for that as well. And we support arbitrary network topologies, everything from a star topology, peer-to-peer mesh networks that is also supported, that Wayne mentioned and we'll be talking about in the 103 lecture. And one thing that can't be said enough, of course, is the OpenStack protocol for replication. So this was designed in part by CouchDB and supported by a number of other systems now, including CouchDB on the client side. So that's also fully documented. So now we're going to dive into building and running an app that's using Couchbase Mobile. So you heard all the great things about it. How did you get started? How did you go about doing it? So throughout the next 20, 30 minutes or so, I'll be diving both into iOS and into Android code. I'll be toggling back and forth between the two. The slide in particular is talking about iOS, so you can reference the top there. For those in the back, it's hard to see. There's also the bottom logo. But referencing the top and bottom can give you your platform I'll be referencing. So for iOS, you need to install Xcode. Let me go back here. You need to install Xcode, which is an IDE. If you already have that, it's great. You download Couchbase Lite's framework from Couchbase's website. And I'll provide all the URLs at the end and also in the blog. So no worries if you don't take down those links. You would download the Grocery Sync sample application and the source code. That's also on GitHub, and we would basically install the Couchbase Lite framework into the sample app, and then run the sample application. So that will be our agenda for the day, and we're going to be referencing the APIs on it. So to do that, imagine you already have Xcode installed, so first step is already done. So the second step is downloading Couchbase Lite. So for this one, it's iOS, so referencing iOS. We support multiple platforms, of course. Download that, unzip it. There's the Couchbase Lite framework.framework file. That's the one that we will be using and needing for the project. So copy that, drag that over, or save that accordingly. The next step is downloading the sample application, which is on GitHub. So the link will also be provided at the end. So you can just unzip the archive there, or simply git clone inside your terminal. What happens next is simply you have these two components. You unzip your Couchbase Lite framework. You drop that into the framework's folder, and you're good to go. So the next step after you put that in there is simply double-clicking the sample app project, Xcode project file, and you'll launch your iOS project there. And at that point in time, you have a working sample application that's using Couchbase Lite on the client side. On the Android side, you would install Android Studio. So this one's referencing Android on top here. You install Android Studio, which is the equivalent of Xcode in iOS. And you would need Android SDK 19, build tool 19 parts. You would check out the sample code repo. From then you will import the Gradle file into your Android Studio. And the import process here for Android is actually you would check out and install the Couchbase Lite framework for you. So it's very nice and seamless all together. So with the with Android Studio, you just simply click debug, run, and you're off to go. So what this looks like here, if I actually do it, if I don't want to switch off to another screen, in your terminal, reference the URL for the project. You can click git clone it. Again, I'll put this on the blog at the end. From there, you can do it in command line. You can do it. You can download it directly through the archive. With Android Studio, you then import the the build.gradle file from the repo and simply run it from there. So I want to show a quick demo on how you can actually, for this application that we're talking about for iOS. I won't show the downloads part, the dragging frameworks things. I think those are things I just kind of shown. It's kind of necessary pieces, but I just want to show what kind of app we're talking against for all the API code that we're going to walk through. So imagine I already step one got Xcode Xcode IDE. Step two, download the framework, Couchbase framework, unzipped it, copied the framework file, drag that into the repo of the sample app that I git cloned. Once I do that, drop it into the frameworks folder. I double click on the Xcode project. Once that's here, I'm looking at the same screen that you guys should be looking at. So what happens is that if I run this, I have a simulator that pops up. I'm referencing iOS 6. I actually love cooking, to be honest. I got into culinary, but ended up doing engineering. And I think it's very similar. So here's just like a grocery list item. You got some bread, you got kimchi, you got dumplings, you got chocolate. You know, I had some chocolate this morning on my phone. I clicked on it. So right here, dealing with an app like this, we're talking about eventual consistency. So everything that you type inside the app, it's actually local and persistent to disk already. So if I actually shut the app off, open it again, the actual items will be persistent and comes up again. So for example, if I decide to, let's try see me, can I toggle this? Wi-Fi might be weak. See, we should refresh. Let me run it again. So yeah, I don't know if you notice, seaweed pops up in by sesame. I need brown rice tonight. I already got the salt. I'll eat the salt. So this is a sample app that I'll be talking again. So everything that all the operations are done locally. So you have full CRUD operations supported locally. So what it means is that if I actually close this app, open it again, all these content will still persist there. And that's the value of Couchbase. Couchbase is handling that. Couchbase Lite here is that framework embedded on your client side that's doing all your CRUD operations programmatically, of course. So let me switch back to the presentation. So next we're going to take a tour of the API for Couchbase Mobile, Couchbase Lite in particular, and focus on the individual bits of the source code as dealing with the content of what we just saw in the grocery store sample application. Lite, it's full house. So I'm starting off with initialization. That's when we start off the app. So at launch, basically launch a document and inserting new documents. In our context, if we insert new documents, it's like inserting a particular item like kimchi or like seaweed there. So that will reference itself as a document here. So for Apple, for iOS here, at launch time we create a CBL Lite Manager instance, which is the top level Lite object. Then we ask it for a database with a particular name. This will have the side effect of creating a database if it did not exist already. We have this one that we call, or we make, or we start it up, and part of it, we get the database object, which we then assign it to self.database so that we have a handle to reference it to later. Then we have some rudimentary like error handling code, so in case like we can't retrieve the database, we've got some error there to handle, error code to handle. The Java version for Android now, moving to Android, is basically the same logic. It's instantiating a manager. The Android code has package names, of course. So over here, we don't use CBL prefix the way that Objective-C does. We instantiate the manager, giving it the Android context and telling the manager to get the database. So whenever practical, we're trying to reference and use the same API names and context throughout. So over here, it'd be the manager class, the get database, with variations, of course, if necessary, because we're using different platforms, and different platforms with different idioms altogether. So where, for example, event handling and notifications are done completely different between platforms like Objective-C, Java, and C#, we will reference those.
In Java, are you participating in like Matcher and all that type of stuff as well?
I would say, hold on to your question. I have
okay.
So much to go through.
Cool.
Yeah, I can't diverge right now. There'll definitely be time in the end to answer some questions. So on the manager, I want to dive in, what are these things? The manager is essentially the top level object. It's usually a singleton on iOS, where objects are initially single threaded. So therefore, if you want to run like CBL on multiple threads in your app, you would need to create a manager of each of those threads to work on the thread that you want. But generally, it's a singleton instance of it. Primarily, this acts like a namespace for databases. We're talking about manager here, manager object. And you can basically ask it for a database of a particular name. This is how you would get a hold of your database. Also, you would locate your database in the file system. You could optionally create a manager and give it a directory path and tell it like where you want to put those documents, those databases. So although it uses a default manager instance here, it's reasonable to pick a location yourself. So like on iOS, it defaults to like I think location support folder, but you can definitely tell where you want to basically save this. Once we have a database, which is a string name called to do, so here's some visual example, we can get a document out of it. And the database is the namespace for documents primarily. And very much like Couchbase Server is that it's a flat namespace, which is pretty much a key value store where the values are these documents containing JSON. And the documents each have this unique name and unique ID. Beyond that, they have JSON as their properties. So there are like JSON objects with a set of name properties where its values can be names of strings, numbers, arrays, dictionaries. So over here I have a simple to-do type object, like a checklist object, with some tags on it to show we have properties on it that are arrays. One way that Couchbase Mobile deviates a bit from Couchbase Server here is that we allow for attachments. So since it's not very practical or efficient to store binary data in JSON because it gets converted to base64 and then it increases in size altogether, the document allows you to attach any arbitrary size binary blob, and which are also tagged with names and line types. Therefore, attachments also help optimize replication, right? So if a document is updated without updating an attachment, the replicator can skip sending the attachment again. So you might have, for example, like a music app or iTunes application type where you have lots of music files and lots of metadata, and when you update the track itself, the huge file itself doesn't get synced, but the metadata gets updated. So you can save a lot of bandwidth accordingly for your replication strategy using something like an attachment. So with databases, in addition to being a namespace for documents, it also contains views and their indexes. We get into views a bit later, and it's also, it's almost exactly like Couchbase Server. If you're familiar with the MapReduce strategy or indexing of queries, it contains validation function that allows for validating the structure of a document that gets inserted into your database. That includes insertion locally by the application, as well as documents coming over through the replicator So basically, this gives you a chance to enforce whatever kind of constraints you have with your document schema. And the database also serves as a source, right? Like a source and a target for your application altogether. You can tell it, bless you, you can tell it like how or when you want to replicate to which target and back and forth and vice versa. So it's basically a target for push and pull accordingly to your strategies. Dealing with documents, if you actually open it up, what it is, what it looks like, it has an immutable ID within a document. It looks like basically underscore ID property. And you can arbitrarily nest stuff in JSON. You can create arrays, and you can have nested objects within objects in them. You haven't worked with this before. It's very different than the way you structure your database in a relational setting, because you are encouraged to store structured data into your documents. Like, let's say, for example, an address book app, you probably store all your contacts and phone numbers as an array of strings, as opposed to creating like a phone number table and a separate instance of a phone number table and then join those two together. There's no SQL join statements here. The documents in the database, of course, does not need to have the same structure. This is what makes it flexible. This is what makes it relevant to mobile. This is also why it's NoSQL. The convention is that we use a property called type, simply a string, just reference type as a generic key in there, and that would give us the particular document name that we reference. So documents don't need to have. So for example, you can have like a to-do item, you can have like an address book item. Those are all particular keys and then values of them. So documents are also versioned. So we have what we call over here MVCC, or multi-version concurrency control. This is the key to how replication works and the way how conflict handling is done. When we have like a conflict, it simply becomes a branch on the history of the document. And it is a valid state for a document to be in. And the replicator will transfer the state back and forth. So it means that when there are multiple possible current versions of a document, this will kick in, and then it will prune it back, and it will go back onto a linear branch. So the document tree is essentially what allows you to do that. So let's look at inserting documents into the database for iOS. We're going to look at the create document method here. We will return an ID of a document whose ID is randomly generated UUID here. You can define the IDs that you give to documents, and sometimes that is a very useful thing to do, but in a lot of cases you don't care, you just want like a document back. By having a system generate this, you avoid any collisions or collide with any other documents that anyone else has created. Then the top there, we're creating an NS dictionary where it corresponds to NS object, Objective-C, with the text and checkmark property, which starts at no. So no is not checked, right? And the create app property for capturing the creation date. And since you cannot store dates as native objects in JSON, we're using the utility function for iOS here, JSON object with date. That'll take a COCO date object and convert it into a string in ISO 8601 format, which is universal for that's universally used in JSON. You might wonder why there is a create app field. If you remember from the UI of the sample application, we're not really showing dates in there. The date is essentially used for sorting, so we will display the most recent item at the top and the older ones at the bottom. I will show a bit of the indexing techniques further on. We translate this to Java. There's a bit more code because we're doing a lot more work here to construct the date time string. So the first block at the top there is creating the current time string for the object. And it's also creating its own document ID by sticking the current time to the UUID. The rest is pretty much like equivalent, just in Java. It's in Java. So we call database.createDocument. They create a map, which is the Java equivalent of the JSON object, and put the same properties into the Java map. And then when you call putProperties.putProperties, it basically persists to disk. at that particular instance in time. That's a lot of info, right? So the next thing we're creating is a view on the database. The database is a container or a namespace for the views. So we say view named at by date, and the view, if the view doesn't exist already, then we create it. And if it doesn't, if it does exist, we simply return the view. The rest of the block of code is to set its map block. So this is a map reduce view. So it basically means that it has a map function. And I'll get into that theory very shortly. So MapReduce initially came about through functional programming. It has functional functions called map and reduce. It was basically adapted into means of highly scalable indexing and querying by Google. It's easy to see over, let's say, some formal code or logic. So referencing this particular line, it's saying that we start off with a document. Over here would be a JSON document. And the map function is a function you write that takes that particular document as input and outputs a set of key value parts. So you're extracting the useful info from the document that you want to index, providing it like, hey, here's a key and here's a value. And you can emit none if the document's irrelevant to your index, or you can emit multiple key value pairs if there are several things in it already. The output of that map function that runs across all documents in the database generates an index. So that's the particular point you need. So that index is just like in a relational database, it's just sorted by a key. You can optionally use reduce function, which can aggregate those rows together. You can take rows of the same keys, or actually all the rows in the index, and run a function to define what will coalesce things together. And you can use things like averaging or counting or computing statistical functions. It's not as commonly used, the reduce function, of course, as map, but it comes in handy. So once you have that index, you will run a query on it. The query is mostly done by saying either I want the index entries with a particular key, or I want a set of keys, or I want a particular range of keys. So here is a visual diagram, a visual idea of what we are talking about essentially. On the left, we have a train of documents that's going by. You can think of this as being a chronologically ordered, where every time a new document gets created or updated, will pop into this conveyor belt, and a map function is running along this while it's being popped in. So every time something changes, the map function gets fed that document. The map function calls a function called emit, which takes a key and a value as its parameter. So the map function here decides it wants to emit doc created. In the black bubble there, you see doc created as the key, and the doc title, also in the black bubble, as the value. So on the right-hand side of that table you see there, you see that this index is being generated, and that these key strings are these key strings, which are timestamps, are the value strings, which are the names of the to-do items. So this is what the grocery sync application is actually doing. It's generating the index of all the to-do items that is sorted by key. So since the key is a timestamp, we got them chronologically ordered here. So that's why we have that's why we reference the creation date inside the document. The third column on the right, the index also remembers the document ID of the document that emitted that key value pair. So when you are querying, when you have a row in your query and you can use that, basically go back to a document, you can fetch an entire row here, or you can just get the entire row out of the database if you want. So the key and the value is enough for you to do everything, get everything out of it. So back to code, hopefully this makes a bit more sense with MapReduce. And coming back to iOS, the first thing we do is get the date out of the document by looking at the creation app, create app property. And if the document has one here, then we emit that as the key. In the grocery sync application itself, it's not emitting anything for the value, because it's actually going back to grab the document itself to get the string. It's getting basically the entire data set. And there is a version string at the end there, which is used to tell the database that if the map function changes, if a map function change from one run to the next, you simply bump the version string number up by one. So you can just, so it basically tells the database that you can throw away the index and rebuild it accordingly. So on Android, this is the Java version, very similar as before. We call database.getView. And then we are creating the map function, which is Java, which in Java exists as a mapper object. So we use some interclass syntax here to create the map function for it to do exactly the same thing as previously on iOS. Now we got basically the stuff in the index. We want to use that index to drive the table view, which is the main grocery sync user interface. So in iOS, we generate a query that is uname by date and call the query, which creates a query on it. Then we see like live query there, where it's basically a special subset of the query that will actually track the view over time. So I think Wayne mentioned a bit about this. I'll talk about it too later on. So we basically set the descending property to yes, because we want to get the rows in descending order of the dates in order to have the newest items on top. So here, this is some very iOS-specific code where we have our data source, which is driving the table, and we are telling it about the query, and we are also telling which property to show as the table, as the label, excuse me, in the table view. So Android version starts up the same way. It creates a query and calls the live query method on it to generate the live query. It calls the add change listener here on the live query. It is doing a bit more of the work directly here. It doesn't have the same platform specific classes as iOS does, so you gotta manually write some more code. So this code here below, this change method is going to get called for the query updates. That is basically whenever the result of the query changes. So it's going through an iterator to get all the rows out of the query and add them to the grocery sync array adapter that it has, which is a custom class it has for sorting the particular data set over here. Next slide, querying a view. So here, querying is in a more generic form. What this means is that we got the index. We built a couple of the slides ago. We got that particular index from the MapReduce. And the query is going to look at a range of subsets of the keys that's in there. So query has a number of properties. So so that in this case, we limit to three. So we only want to get three rows back. We can also set an offset, which specifies how many rows down to start, and also reverse it too, if we want it. Very often we want, let's say, to set a start key and also an end key to get a particular range of keys out. We might also want to get like all the elements from last month, as an example. And the output for if we run the query is an array of query rows, where each query row is an object and has properties like keys and values and document ID, and also the document property, which will load the document back into the database for you. So live query is a sort of wrapper that's around the query, which listens for change notifications from the database. So when the database changes, the live query will kick off a query again and rerun it in the background. This is of course done asynchronously. So and then it compares the results with the previous results that it already had. And if the results have changed, the live query will signal its own notification events, which your app can then use probably to redraw UI or send like an implicit intent, like an email, based on that particular query. So it's referencing that database. So we have the live query, and we have the UI table view here. And we want to connect them together, right? So we have an application controller code in the middle that's doing that for us. And we put this iOS-specific Couchbase-like class called CBL, UI table view source, which acts like an intermediary that will drive this table based on a query. So then you have your this controller object. This controller object becomes this delegate of the UI table view. And that means it will get notification from the table view about things like when the user tapped on one of the rows, or it also gets configuration that appears of the row in the table view itself. So when you're developing this, right, like in Xcode, like using Interface Builder, you can actually see it in a very graphical form from within within your UI solution area. So the file owner is the top left. It's the application controller. It's basically its view controller. The table source is the custom object on the left as well. And the table view is the mockup of the table view in the main window. The outlets, of course, is what you would drag and drop. Drag and place, referencing your UI. So it's actually showing those connection pieces that I have in the blue chalk there on the right hand side. So back to some iOS code. So this is the a callback that the UI table view source invokes on your controller object, telling it it has a query row and that it has UI table view cell, which is the UI representation of the rows. It wants you to populate that cell, so the method wants you to populate that particular cell itself. So, it basically, that method gets the value out of the query row, which in the case of grocery sync, it's storing all the properties of the document there. So it would be the check mark here and the label or text. So it's actually getting that check property as a Boolean and setting up like the color, the check mark image example, based on if it's checked or not checked. So the CBL table source has this handy ability. So back a couple slides ago, we told you that there was a property of the document to use as the text of the row, so you don't have to set the labels in the cell ourselves, that it's all done for us. On the Android equivalent side, Android is basically, we're referencing the sync adapter class, so it's getting the query row by calling getItem based on the row number in the table, and then gets the document from the query row and gets the current revision. Then it uses the check and text properties to populate the UI controllers in the row. Same logic between two platforms. Next, we're talking about taps, right? So this is coming towards the end of how this application is wrapping up. How we respond to taps on a row, on the table, and how do you toggle the check marks? So so this is a method call upon the UI table view itself on the delegate, telling that a row got selected, which means tapped. So it's going to go to the data source, which is the UI table source object, and ask it for the query row at that particular index and get the document out of it. So now it's basically doing a read, a write, a modify, that entire read, write, modify cycle on that document. It basically gets the properties, makes a mutable copy of the properties where we now have a mutable dictionary that we can update accordingly. Reads the check properties out as a Boolean and writes it back in it as the opposite. So this is like inverting a Boolean value of the check property. Then it calls put properties at the end to save the value back. If in the time window, so like based on the like actual human time, something else got modified or the replicator here changed something, there will be a callback to handle an error for a conflict. So a slightly more complex, in a slightly more complex or feature application, in a feature app, you would do this in your app. It's not done here for the grocery sync application. So moving to the Android version now, we have an on-item click that gets called by Android, by the Android GUI. It's going to get the query row here, and at that position, it gets the document, gets the properties out. It's exactly the same thing here, just logic-wise, but just in a Java syntax. And instead of Objective-C, we're basically it's a set of Objective-C we're basically using Java and referencing the Java APIs over here to handle saving a document. So change notifications, I want to talk about this really quickly. I think I'm running out of time. There's three ways you can do change notification. Database change notification here. You get that triggered each time there's a document change on a database. Document changed, over here is referencing a particular document. A document object you can listen to change notifications from, and also from that document specifically. If you have a reference to a document, the document object, you can listen to change notifications from that document also. And live query will basically post notifications when results sets change. So in iOS, the first two of those are the NS notifications. The live query changes is basically done by key value observing. So you would actually observe for the role of the live query role property of the object to get the specific notification here. So it's actually very nice because it enables reactive programming and GUI programming, which makes you basically consider how you want to architect this. So for example, this means basically you've got your model view controller. That might be a view controller or a view model or any popular variants of that sort. So the view is going to be sending a user event to the Couchbase controller, and the controller is going to be turning around to update the model, which in our case is the database. The controller then goes, the controller basically does not have to go back and update the view, which corresponds to what has changed. Instead, the model will send a notification back telling what has changed. And then the controller can respond to those notifications and redraw it. You recall the slide where I toggled the checkmark over there? So if it didn't have anything in there, it would just redraw that accordingly in the table. So you don't need to, because as soon as you save the document, it's going to trigger a database change that triggers the live query. So that the live query is always like listening to any changes. So you can rerun the query accordingly, which would then tell the application that a role changed, and we will basically redraw it. So what's great about that is that what's great about that is essentially you can do reactive programming with it on a GUI side. Want to talk about replication? We're wrapping up, so this is the last topic, I promise you. So finally, over here, replication is represented by an object with the class replicator, and the replicator can be in one direction, or it could be in both directions. We reference push and pull. Over here to send documents to the server, and pull when we take documents from the server to your mobile device. Replication runs asynchronously, so you can create a replication object, you can configure it, and then you can start it, and from there on you're just running, it's just running in the background. You communicate it by notifications, or communicates with you by notifications. You will see like a database notification, it's updating a document. You can listen for notification that, directly on the replication to get progress on the information or on an error. Replication can be one shot or continuous. So this means like, for example, we're talking programmatic databases and API. You could attach, the replication API to an explicit intent or implicit intent. So let's say on app exit, you want to push everything to the cloud. On app start, you want to pull everything down from the cloud. You can write logic accordingly to when and where you want to reference the API to send data up and down the cloud. Replication can be filtered, so this is really neat. We talked about that a bit, but in code, this is what it looks like to create a to create some replication. And essentially, you're creating an object here, referencing that, and calling start on it or stop on it, and referencing a particular sync URL endpoint of when you want to sync data to and from. Exactly the same logic. I like Android codes, just cleaner altogether. And then you can monitor the replication, right? You can do some callbacks here accordingly, put some error handling cases here all together. But essentially, the cream of the crop is creating a push and pull replication in Android. Next steps, there's two more sessions. There's one I'm doing at, I think, 4 o'clock, which is dealing with sync gateway. So everything I've talked here right now has been local development. So that's basically.